Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Thomas Cole National Historic Site's 11th annual Raymond Beecher Lecture. How many of you here today knew Raymond Beecher personally? Oh, wonderful. How many of you here today knew Peter Hutton personally? Wow, wonderful. Anyone who knew Thomas Cole personally? Yeah, okay, a couple, okay, good. Well, we may not always think of them this way, but these are three universally loved guys. I've read virtually every contemporary account of Thomas Cole by people who knew him. And without exception, people who knew Cole loved him. I know Ray Beecher, knew Ray Beecher, and like many of you here today, I loved Ray. To become captivated by his passion for history and for saving old things for future generations was to love him. And I know from many of the people I've spoken with today that to know Peter Hutton was to love him. In loving these three beautiful souls, we notice another thing they have in common besides their shared love for the Hudson Valley. Each of them, in their own way, held it as their highest mission to make people slow down and take the time to notice the beauty and the wonder of the world around them. Cole, at the very beginning of his famous essay on American scenery, could only say of any American unmoved by the beauty of the American landscape, quote, "How undeserving of such a birthright if he can turn towards it an unobserving eye, an unaffected heart." Ray Beecher's preservation urge was driven by his love for slowing down and appreciating old places that time was on the verge of forgetting. In his books and articles, it was the ordinary, unremarkable people, rather than the famous figures, he wanted us to take the time to notice for what their stories could reveal. And in his silent, meditative films, like the ones you'll experience today, Peter Hutton forced us to slow down and really look at and experience the landscape. Inspired by these three men, I would like to take a moment to slow down and recognize two people who, despite their prominent roles, are easy to take for granted. As you walk through the Cole site and marvel at the new studio and the incredible exhibition inside, which, if you haven't seen it, you only have three more weeks to do, you might not know that what makes it all possible is the limitless energy, passion, intelligence, wit, and staggering hard work of Betsy Jacks, our executive director, and Lisa Fox Martin, our board chair. Because they make it all look so easy, it's easy for us to take them for granted. Please join me in thanking Betsy Jacks and Lisa Fox Martin. Now, today's speaker has been making people slow down and appreciate the worlds of alternative film and video for over 45 years now. Scott MacDonald was finishing his PhD in American literature at the University of Florida when he talked his way into teaching a film class and found his calling. Now the author of 14 books on independent cinema, Scott was named an Academy Film Scholar by the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences, and in the true historic preservation spirit of Ray Beecher, was recognized by Anthology Film Archives in New York City for his efforts on behalf of film preservation. Scott has taught film history at Utica College, Bard College, and Harvard University, among others, and has taught regularly at Harvard's Hamilton College for over 30 years. He is also the driving force behind today's event, and the catalog we have for sale today, featuring Scott's brilliant essay on Peter Hutton. Long before any of us knew we would lose Peter Hutton so soon, Scott MacDonald was urging us to slow down and really look at Peter's work, and urging us to see how the spirit of Thomas Cole and his art movement was very much alive in independent cinema. As he has for so many, Scott introduced us to these wonders, and today he's here to do the same for you. Would you please welcome Scott MacDonald.
Introduction and for the opportunity to do this event. I have to say that it's very moving for me on a number of different levels. This event is really about Peter Hutton, but forgive me if I mention that it's powerful for me on two fronts. In 1971, when I took a job at Utica College over in Utica, I was a confirmed modernist. I thought anything 19th century was outré. I used to make fun of my colleagues who taught 19th century literature. And the gem of the Munson Williams Proctor Arts Institute in Utica is Thomas Cole's first version of The Voyage of Life. The second version is in the National Gallery. I think the Utica version is a little better. But I couldn't stand the painting. It seemed so obvious. It was about, you know, it's four paintings in one. The first one is childhood, youth, manhood, and old age. I just thought, oh my God, this is so ridiculous in the 20th century. For a number of years teaching, I made fun of Thomas Cole when I could, compared to the more modern pieces in the Munson Williams Proctor Institute when I took students there. Of course, they always liked Cole better than anything else I showed them, which exacerbated my frustration. And then I had one of those moments where I just had a thought, I had a thought that sort of transformed my thinking. I was among the first generation of people to teach film studies in American colleges and universities. I'm that old. And at the time, we were trying to figure out what film history was. And of course, when you do that, the first thing you do is try to figure out what its beginnings were. And so I had to look back at the late 19th century, and then I realized there were all these things previous to that, in the early 19th century, that it led up to cinema, that made it possible for cinema to exist. And all of a sudden, I don't know where I was, but I thought, oh my God, Thomas Cole's a proto-filmmaker. Because what you have to do when you look at The Voyage of Life is look at it in long shot, move in to look close, then you move to the next painting and you look back at the previous painting to see how it's different from the new one. That is, you are doing essentially what filmmakers would do with editing years later. It transformed my teaching. I started to take my students to see The Voyage of Life as a proto-cinematic piece. And so for me to be honored by being asked to talk at the Thomas Cole National Historic Site, where I used to take students before it was a historic site, I mean, it was always a historic site, but before it was the place it is now, is very powerful for me. It's doubly powerful, triply powerful, because I'm here to talk about Peter Hutton, who was a dear friend, whose work I've written about and thought about, and whose work has transformed my way of seeing the world over and over again. As David mentioned, I think Betsy alluded to it also, we had been thinking about this event for a long time, and Peter and I had talked about it from time to time as well. And when we heard last June that he was seriously ill, I called up the Cole site and I said, maybe we should do something now. And I'm so grateful for David and Betsy's enthusiasm for agreeing that something had to happen now. Our idea then was that maybe we would, it would pick Peter up. He seemed, when you would talk to him on the phone, even in his last days, he was very upbeat. He thought things would go well, and you know how it is when you find out people are seriously ill, you think there will be a slow fade out, which was not the case with Peter. We had imagined that he might even be here, that having this event, he might get a kick out of it, it would sustain him a little bit in some small way, but alas, that was not to be, though I'm sure he would be grateful for this event. And you should know that because Peter was so beloved both as a person and as a filmmaker, there are many other events doing homage to his work happening around the world, in Vienna, in New York, et cetera, et cetera. So you can watch for those. When we lost Peter, we lost really three things, three people. We lost, and I think anyone who knew him, I almost said who knows him, it's hard to imagine he's not with us. Anyone who knew him as one of the most vital, passionate, fun, unpretentious, the most unpretentious academic ever. Just a total pleasure to be with. A person, there's a Hollis Frampton quote where I can honestly say I never spent one moment in his presence that wasn't a pleasure. I mean, he was beloved. I mean, to a degree that I've rarely seen other people beloved. I mean, it was proved. Bard had a little memorial moment very soon after Peter died, just a couple of days, it feels like, maybe a week. And it was not exactly thrown together, but it was done in a hurry, and I remember, I didn't even know when and where it was happening until the night before the afternoon of the event. And I thought, oh, there'll be a few people there, and I think even the college, Bard College, thought there would be a few people there, and an army of people showed up, hundreds of people showed up. And I mean, that's a tribute to how important Peter was to so many people. Wonderful, wonderful person. He was also a charismatic teacher. He taught many places, Cal Arts, Harvard, Bard College for many decades recently, SUNY Purchase, and every place he went, he was an important influence on his students, some of whom became filmmakers, others of whom learned how to look at film as a result of his work. I suppose his best known student would have to be Ken Burns, the documentary filmmaker Ken Burns, who studied with Peter at Hampshire College. And I think if you know Burns' work, especially his early work, The Civil War, maybe, that the power of that work has to do with its very patient delivery of information. It's not barraging you with things, it's elegant way of doing history. And I'm sure that's a vestige of Peter's influence on Ken Burns, who called Peter, who himself called Peter a national treasure, which is what he was. But of course, we're here not because he was a great guy or even because he was a great teacher, but because of the work he did. And it was very unusual work. There are a few filmmakers whose work is as distinctive as Peter's was. The minute a Peter Hutton film begins, you know it's Peter Hutton. It could not be anyone else, unless it's someone imitating Peter Hutton, I suppose, or someone who feels camaraderie with Peter Hutton. Peter's work is unusual in ways that it seems to me ties him to Thomas Cole, which is why it's so fitting for this event to be happening here. And I think there are literal ways in which Hutton is tied to Cole, but there's also a fundamental spiritual way as well. And so let me jump to Cole just for a moment. Cole instigated the Hudson River School of Painting, which was the first great American flowering of a truly new world kind of painting. Before that, there had been big paintings of historical events and portraits of stars of society and stars of history, but there wasn't much attention to the American landscape at all. And Cole is the one who brought attention to the landscape, the idea that it should be something that painters should care about, that people should look at, should think about. And he did this, Cole, in many different ways, but one of the ways is that he looked at the landscape through a lens of the past in order to force those who saw the paintings to think about the future. There's one Cole painting included in this beautiful catalog. I'm astonished at how wonderful it is. But River in the Catskills is the one Cole painting included here. And it's a beautiful pastoral piece of the Catskills and the area around the Catskill clove that we look at, we can see from across the river here. And it looks just absolutely pristine. And even the locomotive that's visible in the film, just by the little smoke from the smokestack of the locomotive, it all seems very sweet. It seems like a gorgeous place, one you'd love to live in. But we know that at the time when Cole was painting these paintings, and this painting in particular, the Hudson Valley was in the process of major industrial development. It was everywhere. And even that railroad that he's alluding to in the painting, was causing far more interruption of people's lives than is visible in the painting. So what we know is that Cole was painting the world, the Hudson Valley world, the way it used to be, the way it was not very long ago, as a kind of warning about where it might be going. He wasn't against industrial development. He knew that there had to be development and that it was going to be development. The question was, how would that development occur? And so one way, one strategy that he had was to ask people to think about an earlier moment, to think about where we are now in relation to that moment and be concerned about where we were going. The other strategy, and this was not confined to Cole, of course, it was true of other Hudson River School painters, was to ask you to slow down and really look at the work. In fact, when you first look at River in the Catskills, you don't even see that locomotive smoke. It takes a while for you to even notice it. And all the Hudson River painters, Church, who was Cole's student, Bierstadt, the Rocky Mountain painters, and later the Luminists, who did beautiful small landscapes that focused on light as a spiritual entity, and then later the tonalists who were interested in moments just before darkness. All of these painters wanted you to slow down. They saw what was coming, they saw that the world was transforming very quickly, and so the issue was how to get viewers of the paintings and viewers of the world to look more carefully at what they were seeing and recognize what needed to be saved, what needed to be honored. So even saying this in this way, you can see, building on what David said in his introduction, where Peter Hutton comes in. Peter was working a century plus after Cole was painting, but his issue was the same one, and the same one that it is for us in the Hudson Valley, and in areas near the Hudson Valley. The question is, how far can development go? And how do we learn to not take for granted the beautiful world that we live in? Like Cole, Hutton used strategies that were very similar. The most obvious one is, oh my God, Peter's films are silent. They are some of the most silent films you will ever see. A number of people have mentioned that once sound film came in, once silent film was over, and of course silent film was never silent, there was almost always music, there were often sound effects, but once sound film became a possibility, real silence became one of the options. And no one made more powerful use of silence than Peter Hutton. So he made silent films in a sound era. He made for 30 years black and white films in a color era. His model for his films tended to be the Lumiere brothers, who invented cinema in the first place, who did single take 50-second shots of everyday realities that they thought were worth looking at, and their approach was something that Hutton never took for granted. So I'm going to show you a couple of Peter's films, and you will see that unlike almost any other film you would see, this is especially true of Landscape from N.O., which is the first film I'm going to show you, Hutton starts out slow and then slows down. The shots at the beginning are like 20 seconds long, the shots in the middle of the film are more like 45 seconds long. So it's the opposite of every other aspect of commercial media that we're aware of. Everything barrages us all the time. It's hard to keep up with what's going on. I mean, it's like I go to watch previews of coming attractions at the local multiplex in my town, and I'm exhausted by the time the movie starts. It's such a barrage. But you will see the unbarrage in Landscape from N.O. It's not just that the shots are lengthy, they are separated from one another to cleanse the palate so that you can really look, so that you can take time to look. So we'll start with Landscape from N.O. I should mention that Minot is the name of Peter's daughter, Minot Hutton DeWeese, who is with us today. I don't know whether I should point her out. Manon, she's sitting right in the back there. Peter was immensely proud of Manon. She's a composer, musician, renowned in her own right, a wonderful artist in her own right. And you will see her, you have to look carefully, you will see her in the last shot of Landscape from the Know. Now, it will feel a little weird to have the projector in the room. That was the only way we could do this in this space, but it's also a method that I think Peter would have enjoyed. His films were silent in part so you could hear the projector, so you could hear the mechanics that are making the experience possible. I'm going to show two films. It's a privilege to be able to show them. Prince now, Peter worked on 16mm. He resisted digital, I think largely because all our new digital imagery is widescreen, and Peter wanted to work with a more painterly kind of shape and didn't want to give that up. But at any rate, you will see that the projector is part of the experience. It's meant to be part of the experience. I think nobody's sitting too close to it. So we'll look at Landscape from NO, then I'll have a little bit more to say about Time and Tide, which is the other film we'll look at. So take a look, see what you think.
Yeah.
I want to thank Carl Novosky and his crew for being so sweet about making this screening possible. If you would give them a hand, I'd appreciate it. It's Novosny, isn't it? I misspoke. When Peter used to introduce his films, he would tell people that it's okay to fall asleep. You know, that it's, you know, you don't have to worry about paying attention if you don't want to, you can fall asleep. And he used to describe his films as a little bit like daydreams, that you just sit there and let things happen. Very unpretentious way of taking the pressure off an audience that he knew would be shocked by the silence and shocked by the pace. But he was relentless in saying it, and it always got a laugh because people had never met a filmmaker that would say it was okay to sleep during his films. One of the audience members mentioned to me as I was rewinding the film that Peter was colorblind, and that might very well have had something to do with his hesitation about moving into color. He made black and white. He had made a color film in 1970. That was the last one he made until year 2000. So it was like 30 years before he returned to color. And I think the reason he did that is because black and white film stocks were no longer what they had been. And he couldn't get out of black and white film stocks what he was able to get earlier on. And so he made the switch to color. With the film Time and Tide, which is the second film I'm going to show you. It's a little longer than the first. Hutton's films always seem a little longer than they are because of their pace. I didn't mention the landscape for Manon. I should have probably mentioned it was 15 minutes, 16 minutes, I think. Time and Tide's a little longer, the pace is what it is. Each film trains you, I think, to understand the pace of it more carefully. And I love those moments in Peter's films where it looks like a photograph, the image looks like a photograph for a while, and then you realize, no, it is moving. It's slowly transforming as I look. That's what he wanted. One of the great images is that, I assume it's a sycamore tree, the second image in Landscape from Anew that suddenly glows. So you have to imagine Peter standing out there waiting for this visual experience to happen so he could get it. He has to have seen it many times and realized that it might happen. Time and Tide is, I think, a film that's different in mood in some ways from Landscape from Anew. It is later, it's color, it moves slightly faster, and it begins with a complete other film not made by Peter, a film called Down the Hudson. At the very beginning of cinema history, people making films for audiences wanted to sell the idea of seeing those films. And one of the ways they did that for a while was to evoke Hudson River School painting. That is, there were innumerable films with titles like In the Valley of the Esopus, which is a local creek famous for trout fishing. So you would think, from a modern perspective, you'd think, oh, I'm going to see the Valley of the Esopus. And what you really see in the Valley of the Esopus is train tracks going straight into the landscape. And I mean, I guess the valley is to the sides, but you didn't really see any valley there, just the train. And Down the Hudson is the same way. By the time the film is made, everybody knows Hudson River painting, and it has its own audience. Calling it Down the Hudson will evoke these wonderful, serene, majestic paintings, though as you'll see, this Down the Hudson could not be further from the paintings that we know than it is. And I think Peter wants to show us that this evolution of landscape, these environmental changes that take place around us, it's a continuing process where we notice them, then we stop noticing them, we notice them. For early 20th century filmmakers, the excitement of landscape was motion, was things in motion, not so much things being still, but you'll see this in the film. And I want to pose a riddle for you. Many of you, most of you probably, are Hudson Valley area residents, and there is a single shot in time and tide that was not made in the Hudson Valley. And if you recognize it, you'll pull a thread that opens up a dimension to the film that wouldn't be visible otherwise. So I will leave that as a riddle, and I will see how many can figure out which shot is not the Hudson Valley. We'll see that after the screening. So this is, time and tide, I think, is 34 minutes. So it's about twice the length of Landscape from an Up. Enjoy. Thank you. those of you that know Peter will know this, and those of you that didn't know Peter will not be surprised to learn that while Peter did have some academic training, MFA from from San Francisco Art Institute, he spent some formative years as a merchant seaman. And he found that experience as formative on his development as any academic training that he had. And he often talked about how crossing the Indian Ocean at night during a rainstorm revealed to him how many gradations of black there were. He always liked the work at the edge of perception, but some of that came, I think, from the training as a merchant seaman. So, what's the image not shot in Hudson Valley? Anybody figure it out? Yes?
I'll take a couple of guesses. There's one shot from the stern, looking at the stern of the boat towards a couple of bridges that don't look familiar to me. That was one possibility.
I was sort of counting New York Harbor as part of the Hudson Valley. So those are in New York Harbor. Okay. What was the other guess?
And the other one was possibly one where he's panning some industrial buildings, and there's a road above it.
No, nope, those are all Hudson Valley. Yes?
Was it the GE sign?
It is. The GE sign that lights up and goes dark and lights up. I don't know whether it's the longer shot in the film, but it's one of them. And if, when you asked Peter about that shot, that's an image that was made on the Mohawk River in Schenectady. And for Peter, this was an important image because at the time when Time and Tide was being made, there was a big controversy about the fact that GE had unloaded a lot of PCPs into the Mohawk River, which flowed into the Hudson River. And the question was whether to dredge up those PCPs or not. I think that work has been done at this point, but it was very controversial at the time. But it also ties into a kind of environmental awareness in this film. I mean, we're going up and down the Hudson, and often it's quite gorgeous, but there's no question of how much industrial development was still going on and had gone on in this space. That's very clear. And in fact, I think this may be a stretch on my part, but the fact that we see that one what kind of ship it was, but it goes by and you read the name, it's Chemical Pioneer. I think of that as Peter's recognition that filmmaking itself is one of the dirtier sort of cellulite chemical filmmaking itself. Photography and filmmaking was one of the dirtier processes on the planet. And so if you were making films, you were part of a certain industrial process that was very damaging to the environment. So I think Peter might have thought of himself, at least I think of him, as a kind of chemical pioneer, a pioneer in moving not forward but back in order to think about where we were going, but also acknowledging that he was a chemical pioneer, that his work was dependent on an industry that was dirty for the environment. I want to finish with one particular thank you to the Thomas Cole National Historic Site, because I think this event is actually very unusual. It doesn't feel so unusual. I mean, it's a film screening hosted by an art museum, and we know that that's not unusual. I mean, the Museum of Modern Art has for decades been showing films. The Whitney Museum for a long time has been supporting independent film, and there are museums across the country that include film in their exhibition strategy. But this is the first instance I'm aware of where an art institution devoted to classic American painting has formally recognized that the influence of Thomas Cole and of the movement of painting that he instigated was not only on other painters of the 19th century or even on painters of the 19th century and painters in the 20th century, but also on cinema. That cinema is one of the crucial inheritors of what painters in the 19th century created. So I want to congratulate Betsy and David for letting this happen. I am thrilled that it did happen. I think it's a kind of breakthrough and I'm very grateful that all of you came. There is a reception afterward, I guess, right outside. I'll be there if you have questions for me or for Betsy or David. Thank you so much for coming and for your attention.
Okay.